Thank you very much. Okay, so let me recall some definitions. So we are the first definition. Let me for X n. So this is an n-dimensional complex projective manifold is special if we have kappa of X l. This is strictly less than phi for any p positive and any l inside omega p x. This is rank one. For example, locally free subsheaf. If we have this, we have on the other hand other notions. So special implies weakly special. And this implies, let me say, very weakly special. So let me recall that. Recall X is very weakly special. Very weakly special. This means that for any f from x to z, p, where p is positive, so this is a p-dimensional complex manifold of positive dimension for which is dominant rational. Then z is not of general type. Let me recall how this is shown. This is just that you could take L here, which is equal to the lift of kz. And X is weakly special. This is written weakly special if any finite etal cover of X. This is a finite etal cover. We have X tilde is very weak, is very weakly special. And we have seen that there are surface cases, very simple examples of covers in which you have X is very weakly special, but a double cover is not very weakly special. So which implies that this is not weakly special. So we have the difference between these two things, these three things, for example. And I would like to try to explain what is the difference between special and weakly special, for example. The reverse. So we have seen that this is wrong on this example. And to show that this is wrong also, this is more difficult because in dimension two, this works. But in dimension three on, it is wrong. I will explain the difference. And now I have the following conjecture. Is that X is special if and only if, this is now what we wanted to have, but this is a conjecture, of course, if X is potentially dense. Both in arithmetic version, arithmetic and analytic versions. And I don't recall the definitions. I think I will not, but this is an arithmetic property. This is an essentially transcendental property, if you want. And so this is an algebraic geometric property. And what I would like to just to mention is that at the, this conjecture, for example, this conjecture is wrong if we replace for very weakly special. And so this is very, very easy. We have seen that everything is wrong. For example, in this example where we took this quotient double cover, everything here on this side is wrong, for example, and this side is wrong also. So this is wrong for weakly special. This is wrong in the analytic version. Also with weakly special. So this means that there are three-dimensional weakly special manifolds for which are not special and which are not potentially dense in the analytic sense. But the arithmetic version is still open, probably. In my opinion, probably just because the existing techniques are too weak to prove this, to give really examples in the arithmetic version. But let me mention that Abramovich and Kolyotelen have conjectured that this arithmetic version should be true for the weakly special. So what happens is when if the conjecture should happen to be true, which I don't believe, in the arithmetic version, this would mean then the equivalence between these two things would completely break. But okay, I'm fairly confident. But for this, and now I will try to explain where the difference comes from between special and weakly special. What is the difference? Where does this come from, essentially? And maybe in order to see this, yes. So maybe let me state a theorem, an important theorem, which is due to Bogomolov, and which is a perfect illustration and maybe one motivation for the main principle which I gave before. So this means that if we look at this situation, for example, Bogomolov theorem say for any x, any L, any p positive, if we have this kind for L is inside omega p x and has rank one, then we have that kappa of x, L, this is less than or equal to p. So being special, this means that it just excludes the top possible dimension here, which is here. So we exclude this. So we have always this, but with inequality. So this means, in fact, if equality holds, then I will call in this case, I will say that L, this is a P Bogomolov sheaf. So to state it more precisely, what is a P Bogomolov sheaf? This is a rank one subsheaf of some omega P, this is the same P, which reaches the top possible Kodaira dimension, so in which you have this Kodaira dimension is equal to p. So if you want, this means they play a little bit the same role of as being of a general type subsheaves. You see, in the omega p, they have the same role as saying that k, the canonical bundle, has the maximal top dimension. So this is a little, there is a geometric interpretation. Then there is a fibration, in fact. X, maybe I will assume here that I may make some blowups on X. There exists some Z, P, and here this is the same P. This is the same P. I assume that P is positive, for example, so this is P dimensional, such that L is equal to F star of KZ. Generically on X. And so let me state that this is generically on X. And this is really the main point. So because you would, you could imagine that this means, but so if this is the same sheaf, why is not Z of general type, for example? But it may happen. There are many situations in which you have this, but nevertheless, although generically this is the same thing, but there is a difference. And I will just now explain what is the difference on the standard example, which I always took.
But this map is not given by the L.
Is not given by?
The L, L powers.
This map is given, yes, yes, it is given by the powers, yes. It is given by the power, so you will see a more geometric. I will interpret this more geometrically. You will see. Rationalism does not play any role because once you make this, you have just the sections of symmetric powers, of tensor powers of omega p, omega 1. They are completely indifferent to blow-ups. You have the same on blow-ups and on blow-downs. So if you have on blow-ups, you have them also on blow-down. This is Hartog's theorem. So this doesn't make any difference. This is a birational statement. Yes, this is a birational property. No. ZP is not, may not be of general type. If ZP is of general type, then you lift K, and you get something which has a Ithaca dimension P. But it may happen that although Z is not of general type, this is the main point, when you lift this, but it is not sufficient to do this, you will construct another L, which is a little bit larger than KZ, and which still sits inside of omega p. You will see this better on the example. So the example, this is always the same thing. This is the simplest example that you can imagine which exhibits this kind of behavior. So the basic example, this is always the same. And so maybe I will not, I start with an x prime, which is f cross C, and here I have X, which is X prime divided by Z2 here, and so this is an étale cover, and here I have just the projection onto C, and here I have a projection, maybe this is Q, I will call it this G prime, and so this is G, and so this is B, which is C divided by the hyper-elliptic involution, and this is P1, for example. So we have this kind of diagram here, P. And so let me recall that F is just an elliptic curve. C, this is hyper-elliptic. And so I take the operation here. This is by means of a translation of order 2 on F. And this is just the hyper-elliptic involution, but diagonally on this. And so this is étale and so on. This is not étale, certainly. Not at all. And so I assume here that G is greater than or equal to 2. And so here this means that I have here points, Pi for I which is equal to 1. And I think this is 2G plus 2. I have 2 times G plus 2 different points over which I have a ramification. This is the branch points of P. P is here, and so I have this point. And so what happens on this over this point? So what I'm drawing, again, this is X here, which is here. And here I have B, which is P1. And so I have the map J. I just notice that G prime, this is the Ithaca vibration, and this is also the Ithaca vibration for some easy reasons. And so we have these different points, these are the Pi, which are here. And in general, the general points, I have the fiber, which is here just F. And here over these points here, I have a double fiber. This is 2 times Fi, for example. And so I have the same thing here over these different points. So I have this point, and this Fi, this is isomorphic to F divided by this translation of order 2. So I have this situation. And so what happens, so we are interested to see what is G star of KB, for example. What has happened? We can here look at along a fiber. What happens? Here I may take X, Y, and here local. These are just local coordinates centered on a point which is on Fi, for example. And so this will map here to some Z here, which is equal to X squared. This will be X squared. Why is it so? You can lift this, because this is etale, you will have this, and so here you will map X, Y just to X. But here, the map which is here, this will map X to X squared. So you have this Z is X squared. And so what happens now if we lift G star of DZ, this is G star of DX squared, and so this is 2 times X dx. So what happens now is this, what happens is that G star of KB, this is certainly inside in omega 1 of X, but in fact, this, this bundle here, this vanishes at order 1 along each of the fibers, fibers Fi. So this means that now when we lift the canonical bundle, we get something which is inside of omega 1 of X, but which is, in fact, not the, the largest subsheaf, rank 1 subsheaf, of omega 1 of X, which contains this F star. And so this is contained, in fact, if you make the computation. Now, if you lift, for example, G star of DZ, assuming, and here, I divide it by the square root of Z. This is a fractional power, but this is not that important. So what you will get here, this is exactly dx. And so this means that here you can lift things which have poles. Here, which have poles, depending on the multiplicities, which have poles and still remain inside of inside omega 1 of X, if you prefer, because you don't like so much this fractional power, you can, instead of this, you can just lift dz over z power 1, and you take here tensorized with 2. And so this will lift inside sim 2 of omega 1 of X. If you prefer, you don't like the fractional powers, you have this, for example. And so then you will get something which is still inside. So you are allowed, in fact, to take, if you take the tensor powers, actually of this, then you can lift things with certain controlled poles in this. And so the fact, and now we introduce an orbifold base, the following orbifold base of J. I will call it maybe delta J. This is on B. And so this orbifold base, this will be just B. And here, this will be a Q line bundle, a Q divisor, if you prefer. This will be the sum of 1 minus 1 half. In fact, for I is 1 from to G plus 2, and here I will take the points Pi. So this is a divisor. This is a divisor inside of on B. This is a Q divisor. And here, which has the following property, that now G star of KZ, KB, plus delta J, for example, this sits inside of omega 1 of X. And now, if you make the computation, this is very easy. You compute the degree of this, and you will see that actually the degree now will be positive, which is not very surprising. And here in this situation, this is very easy to understand what happens. And actually, you don't have only the fact, the very simple reason for which this is contained in omega 1 of x is just that here in this situation, you also have p star of kb plus delta j, for example. This is exactly kc. Because you have this double ramification, okay? So this thing, this fractional thing, if you now take this inside, this is exactly kc. And so if you lift this, of course, you land in omega 1 x prime, but because this is etal, this means that already the lift here was inside omega 1 x prime. So this is not very simple fact. And so, now, this is completely general. This is general, and I will now explain what will happen in general. And so, yes, and this for this reason, of course, you see that this orbifold, let me call this orbifold, this means that KB plus delta G, this is of general type. General type, this means that the Kodaira dimension of this object, this is a Q divisor, but the coefficients are rational, so this is well defined. The Kodaira dimension is 1, so this is the maximal one. Is 1, which is the dimension of B. So this is general, so this means that for any vibration F, from x to some z, and I assume that this is positive, and so that the fibers are connected, not so essential, but one can define. I will give the definition after, but I will state the result first. One can define the orbifold base from the orbifold base of F. This is a certain Q divisor delta F. And this is Q effective. Divisor on Z, which encodes the multiple fibers. Fibers of F. And so the object of interest will be kz plus delta f. So yes, the orbifold base, this will be z delta f. So we have such a thing like this. And so kz, this will be the canonical bundle of the orbifold. And we can define, so kappa of z and kz plus delta f, this is well defined. And so in such a way that we have the following theorem. F x z as before. Then we have and yes, define z p. P, this is the dimension of z, and I always assume that this is a positive. Huh? By? As before, so this means that this is a vibration. Just a vibration, that's all. Yes. Define LF. This will be by definition, this is F star of KZ. And here I take the saturation inside of omega px. So the saturation, this is the largest subsheaf of omega px, which contains, f star of kz and coincides generically with f star kz on x. So we take just the largest subsheaf. So this is the exact similar situation to what we had here. Here, what we had taken, this, when we take this thing in omega 1, this is just a saturation of, in fact, of g star of kb inside of omega 1 x. So the situation is the same. Huh? This is a subsheaf, but in general, as you have seen that it vanishes along the fibers before. It is a smaller than you have a largest one. Here, you see, what we have, it vanishes here along these fibers. So this means that you can, in fact, divide it by x still inside, and you still remain in omega 1 x. Largest subsheaf. I take a subsheaf, but the largest subsheaf, if you are in something which is smooth, rank one, this will be, in fact, a locally free subsheaf, not necessarily a sub-bundle, but a subsheaf. Torsion-free. Co-kernel is torsion-free. Yes. It coincides. It is reflexive in this situation. The largest one is reflexive. But don't think so much of these technicalities. These are technicalities, and so, but they work. So you have this now. This is the largest one. So you just think that the situation is the same as before, except maybe that the multiplicities are different. Multiplicities may be different. And so we have now this thing, define LF, then we have the important thing is the following, that X and then kappa of X, LF, this is kappa of Z and then KZ plus delta F. This is the interesting formula. So this means that now this saturation, when you take the saturation, the difference is explained by this orbifold structure. And here I am cheating, but I don't want to go into the technical details. This maybe then, maybe put just a restriction because this is unfortunately, when the base is one dimensional, there is never any kind of problem. But if the base is larger dimensional, two or more, for example, then you have birational problems which occur. And the thing is unsuitable. Birational, neat models of F. What I mean by this, is that I have X, F, Z, which could even just be even a dominant rational map. And so I need to take some to change the some Z prime. So here this is birational, here this is birational, and what I have is to compute this on delta F prime, here, F prime. I need to make a flattening and then resolve the singularities and so on. And but I need to do this. Otherwise, the formula could be wrong if you just take the orbifold base here, which I will define. What is delta F? I have not defined it. I said that I will define it. But this was said. One can define, and I will do this now. So this is entirely similar to this. This is motivated actually by this example. So now I'm going to define what is a delta F. So we start with X, which is a vibration, and I assume that the fibers are connected. Connected fibers. Fibers? Yes. For any divisor E inside of Z, this is an irreducible divisor. Irreducible prime divisor. So I can consider F star of E. And so I can write this in the following form. This is the certain sum for a finite number of k's. Of tk, and here maybe I will call them fk plus rest, in which here the sum, these are of course distinct prime divisor, and so here the I'm taking such that f of fk, this is equal to e for any k. So what does it mean? If it means I make, I will split the sum into two parts. There is a part which is not exceptional. So these are all the divisors which are surjectively mapped onto E. And the rest, this is F exceptional. F exceptional, so this means that all the divisors which appear here, I will just ignore them. This is here, this is the reason why I will need later on to make some flattening here. So this is this exceptional. So in some sense, you take, I will ignore them here, but they will take their revenge later. So I need to make blowups. So the rest here, and now I will define a multiplicity. The multiplicity of F. The F multiplicity of E, for example, this will be the infimum over K of the TK. Here the TK, here in the smooth situation I'm considering, these are always integers. They are always integers, so I take the infimum. And here, let me make the remark, which is quite essential. I don't take the GCD multiplicity. GCD multiplicity, this is the usual one. This is the standard one. If you want, this would be M star F of E, which is defined by the GCD of the TKs. And so there is a thing which is obvious, is that MF divides excuse me, this is the contrary. MF star divides always MF. But you may have a difference on the two. So this is the classical. These are the classical multiplicities. And this is, in some sense, the non-classical. Non-classical multiplicities. And now the orbifold base will be defined like this. Delta F, by definition, this will be the infinite sum for E. Ah, excuse me. And maybe a small remark is that MF of E, this is one always if E is not included in the discriminant locus or branch, I don't know, discriminant locus of F here. So if E is not contained in the set of singular fibers of F, certainly I get the multiplicity is one. And now delta F, this is the sum of one minus one over MF of E, and here I take E. So this is a finite sum. And so this is the definition. And will, with this definition, and with this, which I don't explain in details, then you have equality, which is here, which is the same equality as the one that we have gotten here. This extends just this thing.
Is this the same as one?
No, it's not one, because in this, this is the topic is, and the aim is different, because what Kawamata takes, this is the maximum and not the infimum. He takes the maximum and not the infimum, yes. This is different. This is different. But the aim is different also. And he considers only things in which the canonical bundle of the fibers is trivial. This is essentially the situation he is considering. And so we have this, we have a finite sum, and so we get this. And so this is essentially the main thing I wanted to say, yes. And now the, you could define, and so we have, this is the orbifold base, this is Z, and delta F, which is here. This is defined like this. You could define the classical orbifold base, which would be delta star of, this is the same thing, but here you would take MF star of E. This is a smaller thing, and which is E. And the, what will happen is that the formula which is here, it works with the non-classical multiplicities, but it is wrong in general with the classical multiplicities, which are too small. They don't detect things. Here you can't see this in these examples because the fibers are irreducible and you have no difficulty, no difference. Let me maybe, might be of interest. Let me give some, so I take F X to Z. Let me assume that here, if XZ, for example, so this is the generic fiber, XZ is rationally connected, then this implies now that we have delta F is delta F star, and this is zero. You have no thing in the case of rationally connected, and so this is a consequence of a Graber-Harris star. Because you always have a reduced member in the in any fiber. If now x, z, this is an abelian variety, then we have delta f is delta f star, but this may be non-zero. So you have, I don't give the proof, it's not very complicated, but you have this kind of fact. And now I can go to the core map. Core map, this is the following theorem. Now for any x, for example, there is a unique map Cx. I will just simplify with C, which goes from x to some Cx, which I will call big C. Such that one, it's general fibers are special. So general, this means outside a countable union of the strict subvarieties. Unfortunately, if one would know that specialness is stable by deformation, one could replace this by generic for the smooth fibers, but, No, I explained yesterday that for surfaces this is known, but from dimension three on this is completely open. And its orbifold base, C and delta C, this is of a general type. So we have this property. So if you want, this is a splitting. This is a splitting. You have, so you have x, which maps by c, and this is the c. And so you have the fibers, and here you may have some multiple fibers here and singular. And so on, and so this gives you a certain delta c. And so here this part is of a general type, and the fibers here are special. So this is a splitting theorem. So for example, let me, the extreme cases, extreme case, maybe a small remark is that x is defined over k implies c is defined over k as well. This is by the uniqueness of this fibration. So the extreme cases is when c is x, and this corresponds to the fact that x is of general type. And when c is a point, this means that x is special, obviously. You see, you have this kind of thing. Yes, and so let me give some easy examples. The first example is that x, if this take f cross c, where we have the same thing here as here, for example, so then the g prime is the core map. X prime, G prime is C. This is just the core map. Because the fibers are special, and the base here is of a general type. Next. What is delta? There is no delta. Maybe you should call it a C prime here. Delta C prime is zero. There is no delta. You don't have any multiple fiber. But I assume that this G is greater than or equal to 2. So this is a general type, and here this is the special part. The fibers are elliptic curves. So this is quite simple. Now just one prime maybe. We just take X, this is now F cross C, divided by Z2, and this implies now that G is C. And now delta C, this is the sum of 1 minus 1 half, which is here 1 half of pi. So here, in this case, the orbifold base, if you compute it, this is exactly giving the multiplicity 2 to each of these points. So you have the delta, you put the multiplicity here, which is 2, and so you get exactly this orbifold base here, and now we know that this is of a general type, and so we see that we have this. And in general, the interesting fact is that you don't need to know that this is covered by something, you can directly compute it here. But in higher dimensions, 3 or more, for example, it happens that you don't have any etal cover to which removes these multiple fibers. And so in this case, you have really to work with this kind of thing. Let me give a second, which is an example, which is quite classical. This is the Ueno fibration. Ueno fibration, so if we assume that we have X inside of E, which is an abelian variety, then we know, I don't know if you know this, but that here, if you take maybe I will call T, this is the T is inside of O0 of A, so this is just the translations of A, which preserve, this is the sub, the unit component actually of the group which preserve. Preserves the maximal one, which preserves x. So this means that these are the translations with which preserve x, for example. And so in this case, we have a divided by t. This is a certain a new torus, maybe which is A prime, and here you can map it to Z, which is its image, which is inside of this, and so you have a vibration, which is the fibers are T. Here, this is a T vibration, this is a principal bundle over Z, and this is of a general type. And so this is another example of the core vibration. So this is the core map for X, because here the fibers are special and the base is of a general type. Unfortunately, this is a little bit too simple, because here we don't have multiple fibers, and so no orbifold structure. But if you take now covers of A prime, not necessarily etal, then you have a Kawamata theorem. I didn't try to check exactly what it is, and you have something similar which happens. But I believe that here in this case, you would get exactly some core map, which is more interesting in the sense that you have a real orbifold base. So you have this. Now you have this splitting, maybe some brief corollary. I will not state everything. I will forget this. So, in fact, let me add some small things. That this is functorial. This is functorial, birational, and etal. Etal in the sense that if you have X prime, functorial, this means the following. If I have a map X to Y, F, this induces, and here I have CX to CX, and here I have CY, and this goes to CY, for example. And here I have a map CF, always. This is not very difficult to show by using the uniqueness. So this is the functoriality of this property, this birational, and this is etal. So etal means the following. This means that here, in this case, if this is etal, finite etal cover, then this will not be etal in general, as we see here. Do you see? Because if you take this X prime, this F cross C, and here we map to this, we see that this is ramified. But in the orbifold sense, this is etal, in the orbifold sense. If you you define what is the etal cover, this is orbifold etal. So in some sense, you have this. But in particular, this means that we have dim Cx is dim Cy if F is etal finite. Etal finite. And so this shows also in particular that if this is, if y is special, so this means that this is a point, this has to be a point, and so x is special. So this gives the result. This is the uniqueness which plays a role here. Maybe I will stop here for this kind of thing. There are many more things that one can say. What I would like now maybe just say is something. Okay. I will maybe mention what are the natural the conjectures. So do you see? Now, if we take any X, we have a geometric splitting of X into two parts. We have special fibers here, and we have something. A special part, and here we have a general type part. And so the conjectures say that actually this splitting should be also arithmetic and analytic. And so let me state the conjecture, the general conjecture, which can be stated without orbifold structure, the general version. There is a more general version, actually, which is valid also in the orbifold category, but will not state it here. For example, yes, so the analytic version, which is maybe similar. For example, so this means that I take Cx to C. Cx, this is a small, the core map. So we have this, this thing, and so the conjecture is there exists W inside of C. So this is a C, this is, and this is algebraic closed. Strict. And I will call U, this is C, minus W. So this is the big thing. The big thing. So I have maybe here, I'm in C, and here I have some W, and U is the complement of this thing. And here I will map here X, which goes to this, and here I can take, this is here F minus one of W, which is here, and here what I have, this is F minus one of U. And so the conjecture is this, the analytic version is this for any. Yes, and here I have the fibers, which are here. For any H from C to X, either H of C is contained in W, or H of C is contained in some fiber of C. This is not F minus one, this is C minus one. C minus one, this is C. This is the core map. This is the core map for some fiber of C contained in U. In F minus one, C minus one of U. C minus one of U. So if you want, you take some H. And so you go to X here. And so you take the composite here from this. So what does it say? It says now, this is of general type. You can see this, although this is only an orbifold, but you consider that this is an object which is of a general type because of multiple fibers. So this is of a general type. You assume, even if you prefer, that C is of general type itself. Do you see? The point is that if you, this C, for example, this map C, assume that this is transversal. So it means not constant here. So you go like this. But now, at some point, you will meet the multiple fibers. And so these multiple fibers, they will give you actually something which is, which has some contact of order with the orbifold base. And so in order to cross this, this has a cost. This has a cost, and this prevents them from being non-constant. They can't cross this upside because this is of general type. Think of this, for example, where you have these double fibers. Here, you try to do this. You know that this is of a general type. When you project it, this had to be of a general type. Assume maybe the best thing is to, the simplest thing is to try to, if you go there to the etal double cover, you see that this has to be to lift, but then now this implies that it has to be vertical here, and so this one had to be vertical. So crossing the multiple fibers, this is very difficult. And so the difficulty is encoded actually in the orbifold base. And so H goes to this, and so you have this C now has to, yes, you go, assume that this is of general type, so Lang's conjecture tells you that the map has to be constant here, the composed map has to be constant, so this means that it has to be contained in one fiber, or it is contained in W. So this is a kind of a version, orbifold version, actually, of Lang's conjecture. So you have this. And now, so this is the analytic version, and so the arithmetic version is similar. Maybe, I don't know, if you want to see this, oh, I will say this nevertheless, that for any k prime over k, if I consider x of k prime, Yes, I will take C of x of k prime. So this means if I have a k prime rational points here, I mapped them here. Assume that this is of general type, then these points have to be finite here. Then C of x intersected with U is finite. So this means that the k prime rational points of x should be contained in only in finitely many of the fibers outside of the image of W. And now the second part would be, we have this, and if k prime over k is sufficiently large, then x of k prime is Zariski dense in over in any fiber of C of X of K prime intersected with U. So I will give you. So this means that now this is contained in finitely many fibers over U, for example. And if the field is sufficiently large, they will be even dense in the finitely many points which are mapped here. So this is a conjecture fairly, I may take still 2 minutes just to conclude. And so the last point. And tomorrow I will give some more leisurely things, some examples in low dimension for this. The last point is that this conjecture, this general conjecture can be reduced to proving it for no longer for manifolds, but for x and delta. These are smooth orbifolds. So these smooth orbifolds, so this means that you take things which are similar to what we have defined. And so this means that x is smooth and that delta, the support of delta, is of simple normal crossings, such that either k plus of x delta is minus infinite, or k of x delta is zero. And so this, you want potential density, or kappa of x delta is dimension of x. So this is the general type case. So if you want, in order to prove this general conjecture, which is here, it would be sufficient to show this for the primitive orbifold. But one has to extend this to the orbifold situation, the smooth orbifold situation. So we have this. Why is it so? And I will not give the detail, because assuming the result is that assuming a version of CNM orbifold, what we get is, assuming this, we can decompose the core is something like this. This is what we saw yesterday. This is a decomposition into rational quotient and Ithaca, Moisés, and fibrations iterated. But here now we have to take into account orbifolds at each step and to define what we need definitions here. We need definitions to be given in this thing. I will not do this. This is not a very complicated topic. But we need, yesterday, instead of CNM orb, we could have used just CNM in order to construct this thing. Yes, okay. And so I will maybe stop here. If you want to have more details, I can give it to you. Huh? No, 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 no. Here, this is kappa plus. Kappa plus in the definition. No, this is not this. Means that for any f which goes from x to z, for example, and here I have a certain delta, and here I have a delta, but here the delta depends not only on f, but also on delta. This is a bigger thing. I have not defined it the general version. Did I? Is it? Ah, no, this is no longer here. But so you can define here an orbifold base if you have also an orbifold structure on this. And so the definition means that for any f, I have kappa of z, and then kz plus delta f delta, which is here, but this is minus infinity. I want to have, this is the definition. And so this is clear what it means as soon as the definition is given. This is a small variant of what I did before, so I don't have it. This is no longer directly connected with rational curves, but I conjecture also that this condition should be equivalent to being rationally connected, but for orbifold rational curves. And I will define them tomorrow. I will define also at least what are the rational points in a very special situation on P1 and some orbifolds, and so, and the state orbifold model conjecture. So we're stopping here.